I have the honor to present for you Dr. Alan Poling. And Dr. Poling is professor at psychology at Western Michigan University. He received his PhD from the University of Minnesota, a fellow of Division 3, 25 and 28 of the American Psychological Association. Dr. Poling has published 12 books and roughly 350 articles and book chapters, and has served as a research advisor to certified PhD recipients. They and he have conducted research and done conceptual work in several areas, including behavioral pharmacology, clinical psychopharmacology, with special emphasis on the effects of psychotropic drugs in people with developmental disabilities, applied behavior analysis, gender issues, animal welfare, quantitative analysis, learning processes, and research methods. Dr. Poling was recognized as a distinguished faculty discoverer at Western Michigan University in 1996 and as a distinguished alumnus of West Virginia University in 1999. In 2003, he received the Western Michigan University College of Arts and Science Outstanding Achievement in Research and Creative Activity Award. This year, he has received a Lifetime Achievement Award for the California Association of Behavior Analysis, a Translational Research Award for the Association for Behavior Analysis International, and an International Humanitarian Award from the American Psychological Association. I'm so pleased that we have Dr. Poling here today, and I look so much forward to hear the work he has done on with APOPO and the Hero Rats. Welcome.
Thank you for the kind words. I appreciate the hyperbole. Basically, I'm old, so I've had a chance to do a bunch of things, and I've had a lot of fun doing that. But I've never had more fun than in participating in the work that I'm going to talk about today. And if I can find the device here, okay.
Can we get the lights?
Someone, so we can see. That work has been done under the auspices of APOPO, and that's an acronym. It's used to describe a Belgian NGO headquartered in Tanzania. And
goes wrong way.
There we go. I learned, but slowly. APOPO, as I say, is a Belgian NGO, and it uses PALSTRATs for humanitarian purposes. And those purposes so far have been to detect landmines. The rats are used in humanitarian demining, and they're also used to detect tuberculosis in humans. And I'll talk about both of those applications, and I'll also talk about some other possible applications. The rats aren't being used operationally in those operations, but we hope they will be before too long. Now, the first thing I want to emphasize is that the work I'm talking about is in no sense mine. It's the result of a team effort. I've done what I could to contribute, but I'm not a leading player here. I'm a role player. I helped to row the boat. But many people have done as much or more than me. And I want to acknowledge just a few of those people. Two of those people were visionaries at APOPO, Bart Veachens, who had the idea of using the rats for humanitarian purposes, and also Christoph Cox, the longtime CEO of APOPO. Nothing would be done without those people. Five of my students have lived in sub-Saharan Africa and elsewhere, and they've done a great deal of good work. Two of those people, Tim Edwards and Amanda Mahoney, have served as head of behavioral research and training at APOPO, and their services are invaluable. There's a sixth student who isn't mine, I wish you were, but she's done great things. That's Haley Ellis. Haley's here today, And she did a presentation yesterday. She's doing wondrous things, and thanks, Haley. And thanks to my students. My family, my children, my wife have lived with me in Tanzania on multiple occasions. They've let me live and work there in their absence, and their support has been wondrous, and I appreciate that. Now, the day-to-day work of APOPO is done by locals from a bunch of resource-poor countries, and they're the guys and gals who get the job done. There'd be nothing without them. There are some members of the TB research team and also the clinical detection team in Tanzania. There are some of the deminers. If you envision a crap job, it's demining. It's hot, it's hard, surprisingly it's often boring, but of course it's dangerous. And the guys and gals who do it for APOPO do yeoman service day after day after day, and I appreciate that. I also have a lot of professional colleagues who contribute to APOPO's mission. And I list a half dozen of those people simply to illustrate that they come from many nations, they literally speak different languages, and they also come from disciplines that differ widely. I don't work with behavior analysts at APOPO, save for my students and Haley. And the first challenge I faced was communicating with these people, in part because I don't speak anything but English, and I don't speak that too well. All these people speak some English, but they aren't necessarily fluent. But that apart, there's a problem, or a potential problem, that we come from disciplines that study and explain relations between environmental inputs and behavioral outputs in different ways. And for me, behavior analysis involves searching for orderly relations between things that happen in the world, environmental inputs, and changes in behavior, behavioral outputs. And we isolate those, we categorize them, we give them names, and that's how we explain the world and predict how behavior is going to change. Well, people in different disciplines often have that same general goal, but they use different terms. They explain things differently, and to work effectively with people from these different disciplines, I had to get off my behavior analytic high horse. I had to learn about what they do. I had to give up technical terminology, which wasn't hard for me. I avoided as best I can. I haven't used contingency for 20 years, except derisively. And when I work with these people, when I work with a dog trainer, it didn't matter to me if they call a discriminative stimulus a cue or a conditioned reinforcer a marker, as long as we were talking about the same operation and concerning ourselves with how it affected behavior, who cares, right? I would use their terms if it worked better. So our challenge initially was to sort out the language we used, and the second challenge was learning how to use our language, but we succeeded.
Can you hear me without this? If you can hear me, raise your hand. I'll be can't hear
it. All right, sorry. So we had that challenge, but we got some things done. And we've published our results in a bunch of different journals. And of course, that's another challenge. All the work we do at APOPO has a practical function. We're trying to help people, one way or another. And to do that, we often try to make the rats better. And I'll talk a bit about how we do that. But depending on the kind of work we do, there are different appropriate audiences. Sometimes we're trying to convey information to medical professionals. Other times we're conveying information to learning theorists. So we have to come at things from a somewhat different perspective. different audiences have different requirements for publication. And a thing that served me well is the ability to write quickly and fairly well for a bunch of different audiences. And if you can't write a paper as though you're writing for JAB or JAVA and publish it in a medical journal, it just won't fly. But that's okay with me. You know, I'll abuse the language from a behavior analytic perspective if that's what's necessary to get our work out there. But that was a challenge that we faced. For me, it wasn't a big challenge because all my life I've worked to please different audiences. But it takes some time, I guess, to acquire those skills. Now, of course, we use PAL strats. And there's a picture of one. The scientific name is Chrysidemes ansorgae. They're only vaguely related to the lab rats, the rattus rattus that you may know. They're large rats. They're about as large as a person's forearm. That's the body. Tail's about the same size. They're native to sub-Saharan Africa. They're nocturnal. They're agricultural pests. People eat them. They taste like squirrel. That's a joke. Nobody ever laughs. But where I grew up, we eat squirrels, so it's funny to me. I've never eaten a pal strat, actually. But people do. And they're widespread. People see them as vermin. But they have some advantages for the applications for which we use them. One is that they're long-lived. APOPO has rats that have been working operationally for 8 years. It takes quite some time to train them, so you want a long working life, and we get that. Although they're large enough to see, they can walk right over landmines without exploding them. A dog, for instance, can easily explode a landmine, but not a rat. We've never had a mine explode when a rat walked over it. They're robust. They're largely disease-free. The only problem we had in the early days is they get cancers on their ears and on their tails. But we deal with that. We slather their ears and tails with sunscreen. And I often laugh thinking about the woman or man who does that work, explaining it to her, his friends or family. You know, well, what do? We pay the people quite well by local standards. And so someone goes back to her, his village, and says, you know, I'm making 100 times what you do. Oh, how do you do that? Well, I grease up rats. You know, it must be bizarre for them. But it's necessary, and it works quite well. As I mentioned, the rats are used for 2 applications. One is humanitarian demining, clearing areas of landmines. Those of us who have the good fortune to live in rich countries may not be aware of the problems posed by landmines, but here you can see the countries where they are a problem. They cause about 20,000 casualties a year, but that's not the big harm they do. The big harm they do is they deprive people of access to valuable resources. They also typically injure, not kill people. They're designed with that in mind. Of course, the notion is, in warfare, if you hurt a military person, then her or his colleagues have to care for that person. So if I take shrapnel to the abdomen because of a landmine, well, 3 or 4 of you have to drag my sorry butt back, right? And care for me. It takes 3, 4, 5 people out of action. If you kill me, it's just me, right? So these anti-personnel mines are intended to maim. And of course, in the resource-poor areas where landmines are a problem, caring for injured people is a huge burden. So landmines are a scourge, and there's reason to deal with them. Now, if you have the will, the political will, which means the money, it's not hard to find landmines. Think about Europe after World War II. There were landmines everywhere. And those areas were cleared pretty quickly, were they not? But wealthy nations dedicated themselves to that purpose. In much of the world, there are landmines, but nobody gives a shit. You know, people give a lip service, yeah. APOPO's working in Cambodia, detecting explosives dropped by my country, by the United States, back during the Vietnam War. The United States spends as much on that effort in its totality in 1 year as it spent in 1 day dropping those munitions, just to give you an idea. So in resource-poor areas, there's need for inexpensive landmine detection devices. And that's what Bart Veachans envisioned the rats to be. So landmines are a problem. I kind of knew that when I started the APOPO. I didn't know the scope, but I knew it was an issue. Now, to train the rats, we use operant conditioning procedures. It's just a straightforward discrimination and training kind of an arrangement. We start in the lab, and then we move to more and more naturalistic settings. And eventually, the rats are trained on a 70-acre field that contains about 1,500 defused landmines. I'm not going to talk about training, but we've sorted out how to do it. Takes about 7 to 9 months to train a rat. We could probably do it faster, but we don't try to. Labor's cheap where we do the training. APOPO's devoted to supporting the local economy. And moreover, the rats aren't physically mature until they're a year old, so there's no point in training a rat in 3 months. But these are the steps. It's critically important that you gentle the rats early on. Wild pouch rats are nasty. I mean, they're just horrible animals. But APOPO sorted out how to make them tractable. And we spend a lot of time doing that. There are my kids working with two young rats. I guess you could say two rats working with two others. But Jesse, my daughter, is just rubbing one. And my son is teaching a rat to eat from a syringe filled with nice banana. That's how we deliver reinforcers on the minefields. Real low tech, right? You take a big syringe, you mash up a banana, you stick it down and the rat eats from it. Or, if you don't have a syringe, you just peel a banana and stick it down, let it have a mouthful and jerk it away. Not very technological, but it works. So that's the first step. That's the last step. That's a rat that's found the landmine. Usually they aren't that obvious, but certainly for appearance sake, we staged this. Now, this is start. How do we start a video? Anybody have an idea? Somebody know how to do that? I'll just keep talking while we do it. Anybody? Okay, here goes my talk.
Yeah,
I told you it's a team effort. I brought Wayne from Western Michigan University to do a keynote address, and to also help me, which is a bigger job. So that's basically how the rats work. And I think it makes more sense to see them to hear me talk about it. And I'll talk about our research in due course. Now, when I went to APOPO about a decade ago, I thought tuberculosis was a problem 100 years ago, you know, and that was it, but I was really wrong. Worldwide, about 2 billion, that's billion with a B, people have been exposed to the microorganisms that cause tuberculosis, and those people have latent TB, which means that the bacilli are in their body alive, they're walled off by the immune system. And as long as your immune system works, you're cool, right? But if anything compromises immune function, you're in deep trouble. Years ago, TB was called consumption. Well, the reason for that is it literally seems to eat people. They waste away. It's an infection usually of the lungs, and it's nasty. Untreated, almost everybody dies, but it takes a long time to die, and it's a miserable death. Fortunately, antibiotics are almost always successful in treating TB if it's detected early. But detection's a problem. Wouldn't be a problem for you if you were to encounter TB, but in much of the world it is. Now, I might mention that most people who have latent TB never develop active disease, but about 1 in 10 do, and the disease kills about 2 million people a year. Almost all those deaths are in resource-poor areas. For instance, in sub-Saharan Africa, TB is ruinously deadly. It's the major cause of death of HIV-positive people. If you're HIV positive, aren't treated for HIV, and have active TB, you die, and you die now. So it's a bad disease. This is a slide showing mycobacteria tuberculosis. That's the microorganism that causes most cases of TB. And this is how TB is detected, active TB, in the developing world. People get a sputum sample, and sputum is fluid brought up from the lungs, so that's sputum, right? I won't show you, but you get the idea. The way it's detected in resource-poor areas is that sputum is heated to kill infectious microorganisms. It's stained, and then it's viewed under a microscope, usually with 100 power magnification, and those little purple rods indicate active TB. It sounds easy, it's not easy. Microscopy is not very accurate. It misses about half the cases of active TB. Moreover, it's slow. A microscopist can prepare and examine about 20 samples a day. So that's not much, right? Well, years ago, physicians who treated people with consumption reported that their breath and sputum often had a characteristic tarry odor. And Bart Veachens was aware of that, and he thought, well, my heavens, if people can detect TB by smell, surely our rats could, because their sense of smell is far, far better than ours. So he and his colleagues started to examine the possibility of using scent-detecting pouch rats to diagnose active TB. And so that's the second application. Now, here's a little tape showing this application. Again, it's an operant discrimination detection device kind of an analysis. But here, the rats work in chambers, and pots containing sputum are placed beneath holes in the bottom of the chamber. The rats move along and smell those sputum samples. When they detect the bacteria, they pause with their noses in the holes, and that's the indicator response. I should have mentioned on the minefield, the indicator response is stopping and scratching or biting the ground. And that's how we know that they found the landmine. See it moving along, sniffing the holes. So it's going to the start position. They always start on the left side. So Peter's opening covers above the sputum. You see it stop, the conditioner enforcer a click. So now it's getting food. So that's how the rats are managed. Now, we get our training samples from clinics, where they've been analyzed by microscopy. Microscopy is good in that if a clinician identifies a sample as TB positive, it almost always is. There are very, very few false positives. So we can use those clinic positive samples as the splinter stimuli in training, right? We reinforce pausing above those samples. And then once we've trained rats to just pause above those clinic positive samples, we can use them operationally. And of course, some of the samples that are clinic negative are in fact TB positive. And through stimulus generalization, our rats come to pause above those samples. Okay? And those are the ones that may constitute new case detections. And what we do is, if a rat pauses above a sample, then we analyze that sample via fluorescent microscopy of concentrated sputum, which is a better detection device than simple microscopy. So that's how we get the new detections, right? So a rat identifies the clinic negative sample as TB positive, then we confirm that with another technique. Okay, so that's how the rats are used operationally. And I've worked on both those projects, and I'll talk about that. But I went to APOPO to work on a different project. I was hired by the Geneva International Commission on Humanitarian Demining to work on remote explosive scent detection. And shoot, almost 20 years ago, a South African commercial demining company called Mecham Associates reported that they were clearing huge areas of landmines using a technique where they drove armored trucks along areas of concern. They sucked air through filters, and dogs analyzed those filters in a lab. And the notion was they were capturing enough scent molecules indicative of explosives to allow the dogs to identify them. And that's bullshit. It does not work. It's a scam. And people realize that, but there are lots of scams in commercial demining. And of course, if this technique worked, it would be invaluable, because actually clearing an area is slow and costly. So GICHD said, well, maybe there's something here. Let's see if we can develop a viable technique for remotely detecting explosives. So they got APOPO involved to see if rats could do this, and they got Norwegian People's Aid involved to see if dogs could do it. And this project had been going along for some years without a lot of success when they advertised for a behavior analyst to join the fray. And eventually I got hired to do that.
And so I showed up in Tanzania and I looked at the work that was being done. And I knew the funding cycle was coming to an end. And I said, there's nothing for me to do here. Some good behavioral people, although they weren't behavior analysts, had been designing studies, and I didn't want to interfere with that. But I did realize that the model they were using, which was an expat model, wouldn't work. These people would come in, they'd design studies, and then they'd move it up to the trainers to carry out those studies. And that just didn't happen. And then saying that, I'm not in any way disparaging the trainers. You know how hard it is to get intervention integrity anywhere. Well, if you're working in the developing world, it's 10 times as hard. Moreover, many of these studies were complicated. I couldn't do them, and I have some training in science, and certainly the folks who were charged with doing them just couldn't do them. And although I didn't say this, obviously, I didn't want to offend people, I thought if we're going to get any research done here, we need a new model. We need a scientist on the ground to make sure things are being done day to day to day to work with the trainers. And so that's how I decided to get my students involved eventually. The students always do the hard work. But also to go there for a while and work myself. But I said, you know, I'm not going to work on this project save in summarizing what's been done. So I ended up editing a book on remote explosive scent tracing and helping to write some papers. But I didn't get involved in the research. And one thing I learned years ago is, if you can't do a task, if you're going to fail, don't take it on, right? Because you lose all credibility. And if I had promised to develop a viable remote explosive scent tracing operation, I'd have failed utterly because people better than me had failed. So I said, no, let's not do that. Let me help summarize this work, but let me work on something else. And that's how I started working on the direct detection stuff and the tuberculosis detection. So for you young people, there's something there. Make sure when you start a new application that you succeed. Do something of value. And that makes you a condition reinforcer, right? Then your colleagues will take you seriously. They'll help you out, right? APOPO needed to summarize that work. They needed something to give to GICHD. Well, the book that I helped prepare fulfilled that obligation, right? And I hope it's of some use to people. But I tried to make myself valuable by succeeding. Then that opened the door so I could do some things I wanted to do. I mean, I didn't really, you know, care that much about the book, but I did as best I could a work person-like job. So, you know, when you're faced with a new task, set it up so you succeed early on, and then take bigger steps. But if you're faced with an insolvable problem, just call it that. Say, I'm sorry, but I can't help you. Now, when I started to work, I said, well, there's three things we can do. We can ask three kinds of questions. How well are the rats performing as they're currently being used? If they aren't performing as well as we might, how can we make them better? And finally, well, what else might they do that is of humanitarian value? So my students, other colleagues, and I have pursued research in all three areas. And I'll just give you a sample of some of that work. Obviously, when you're demining, quality control is paramount. Every demining technique misses some mines. You just can't help that. But you can't miss very many, right? You declare an area safe and it's not. Well, the sequela can be ruinous for the people who believed you. So we did two large quality control studies, and I won't talk about the details, but the rats were accurate. So we had the rat search an area, and when they're searching, we grid off an area. It's called a box. So we stretch measuring tapes. And alongside of that demarked area, we clear areas, usually with a metal detector. And so then the trainers walk along those safe lanes, and the rats go back and forth between the trainers along a rope. You saw that in the video. And then when a rat digs, the trainers indicate an XY coordinates where that response occurred. Subsequently, people with metal detectors search those areas. when they get a hit, right, beep, 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 then they, and this is horrible to see, they dig out the landline. You saw a person doing that? And that's how we actually find the landmines. Well, what we did in these quality control studies is we have a, well, actually, we always use two rats. We have two rats search an area, and we note where they indicated the mine, and then we have people with metal detectors search the whole area. And in both of the studies, the people with metal detectors didn't find any mines missed by the rats. That doesn't mean the rats are perfectly accurate. They miss some mines, but they don't miss a lot. And that's how we'd like it to be. In both those studies, the false alarm rate was low. A false alarm is making an indicator response further than a meter from an explosive device. And you don't want a lot of false alarms, right? Because then you have to check with a metal detector and so forth. It slows down the show. And the rats didn't make a lot of false alarms. So this indicates, you know, they're doing pretty well. As good as any other technique. Moreover, they're fast. I thought about showing you a video of a person using a metal detector to find landmines. It takes too long. It is slow. It's like watching paint dry. Because as you'd imagine, the people are incredibly careful. You know, I mean, imagine you're walking along behind a metal detector. Well, if you miss a mine, right? Bam, there you go. So they checked and checked and checked, rightly so, and it's slow. But the rats, you know, they're not in any peril. They're looking for banana, right? And so they trek right along. They're fast. So these are two examples of how well are the rats doing. We've done a bunch of other landmine detection work. When you use rats operationally in demining, they always work in extinction, right? Because you don't know where the landmines are. And therefore, it's inappropriate to reinforce indicator responses. Well, you know behavior doesn't persist long in extinction. How do you deal with that? Well, every morning before you start work, you run a rat over a defused landmine. If it detects it, then you reinforce that response, right? The other thing you do is you build a training field in situ, and you arrange reinforcement on that training field. And of course, your hope is that responses that are reinforced on the training field will develop a kind of stimulus control that generalizes to the operational side. That may or may not happen. APOPO started its work in Mozambique. The landmines there were all buried before 1992. That's not a problem for detection. In fact, it's easier if they've been in the ground for a while. But undoubtedly, mines that have been in the ground for 25 years have a different bouquet of odors than mines that are recently planted, right? Well, we can't go back to 1992 and plant mines in our training field. So you're taking a bit of a gamble and resting your faith in stimulus generalization from the training field to the operational site. So we looked at another procedure, and we developed what we call the TNT soaking procedure. TNT is the active constituent in most landmines. So what we did is we put a plastic bag containing TNT on the ground, left it there for a while, removed it, and the rats could detect the odor of that TNT. Moreover, rats that are trained to do that will find landmines indefinitely. You don't ever have to reinforce your response to a landmine to get them to find landmines. So what we can do is, on an actual minefield, we can do this soaking procedure, right? Record where the TNT was placed. Then when the rat makes an indicator response there, we reinforce that. And that'll keep the rat working, actually searching for landmines. So that's one of our work projects. We're starting to use the rats outside of sub-Saharan Africa. Well, there they might be invasive pest species. So we didn't think neutering would affect their performance, but we showed that it doesn't. Technical survey, I won't talk about that, but it's a technique where you believe there might be explosive hazards, but you're not sure. Well, there are algorithms that people use to ascertain whether those areas are hazardous, and those algorithms involve sampling. a part of the suspected hazardous area and you check for landmines there. If you don't find any, you deem the area safe. Well, a fast detection device is really useful in technical survey, and the rats are really useful for that. The rats can work on a pole as well as on a rope. Sometimes there's a lot of vegetated material or rocks, so you can stretch a pole between the, or a rope between the trainers, and in that case, we work the rats on a long fiberglass rod. It's a telescoping fishing pole, actually, and that works. So this is some of our demining work. There's a rat. That's the training field in Morogoro, Tanzania, and that's a rat working on a pole. We've also looked at quality control with the TB detection, and just a couple of early studies. In one, the rats identified almost all cases of active TB identified by microscopy. They also identified 44% more cases that were missed by microscopy. So that's our clinical benefit, right? Increased by about half the number of case detections. We replicated that in some other studies. We also compared the rat's performance to the gold standard for TB detection, which is culturing followed by polymerase chain reaction analysis. And there you look for genetic material that's unique to the microbacteria. And microscopy detected 58% of people who were actually TB positive. Each of 10 individual rats detected about 70%, so the rats are substantially better than microscopy. And again, they're much faster, so that's their clinical value. Also, the rats are fast, so you can have more than one rat evaluated sample. And of course, there you can use different criteria as to what constitutes a rat positive sample, and that can change detection ability. We've done a bunch of other TB research. We examined whether the rats could detect TB by sniffing those slides that are prepared in the clinic, because they're extant, right? They're already done. Well, if our rats could detect TB that was missed by microscopy, that would be useful. And the rats actually can detect TB by sniffing these fixed microscope slides, but they're really not very good at it. Not good enough to use practically. Maybe you could do something to make them better, but we haven't examined that. And one thing I might point out as a challenge is the people who fund our research want us to clear areas of landmines or find TB. They don't want us dinking around with procedures, right? You know, get your butt in gear. Put those rats to work. And that's fine, but we want to put them to work in optimal fashion, right? But sometimes we can't do things as slowly and systematically as we'd like, because there's always this drive toward production. And that's just how it is. I heard a presentation this morning where people were talking about telehealth applications. And it's the same situation there, right? They want you to get that product out there. And maybe you can't do your research quite as slowly and systematically as you'd like. You just have to accept that as reality. And of course, I don't care what kind of research you do, getting it funded is a challenge, is it not? You know, we're always like hustling for money. But, you know, we've succeeded to the extent that we keep doing the work. When microscopists evaluate sputum samples, if they detect mycobacteria, then they count them. And they classify the samples according to bacterial load, from AFB, which is a few bacteria, to +3, which is a lot of bacteria. And there are criteria for the different levels. Well, when there are few bacteria, they're easy to miss. So it ends up that most of the TB positive samples are plus 2 or plus 3. So they have a high bacterial load. So the ones that are actually TB positive that are being missed have relatively few bacilli, right? Well, we get our training samples from the microscopists, right? And the ones AD TB positive are the ones we use as discriminative stimuli to which we reward responses. Well, those are almost all high concentration samples, right? Well, that poses a problem. If you train with high concentration samples and you want your animals to detect low concentration samples, you've trained in the wrong way, have you not? You know, think about the sheep generalization gradients. So we thought maybe we can improve the rat's performance if we artificially inflate the number of low concentration discriminative stimuli that we present. And of course, we just based this on a fundamental principle of discrimination learning, right? And it works. So now what we do is we collect and reuse these low concentration samples, and that makes our rats better at detecting TB positive samples missed by microscopists. So there, just what we knew about basic principles of learning was put to good practical use. When I started with APOPO, they added a sodium phosphate buffer to the sputum samples. They thought it helped. It took some time to do it. It doesn't help, so we stopped doing that. I mentioned you can change sensitivity and specificity by changing criterion. We're thinking about using the rats for first-line screening where there's been no evaluation by microscopy or anything else. Of course, the problem there is you have to get training samples, right? To train your rat to detect TB, you have to know if it's present. So we evaluated a reinforcement for agreement procedure. One rat evaluates samples and receives no reinforcers, but the samples it indicates as TB positive are used as discriminative stimuli for subsequent animals. And that works kind of. We gotta sort out the details of that. Haley talked about reliability. I'm not going to do that. For a while, we thought maybe there was a sex difference in the performance of rats. There isn't. But most of the new cases we detect are males, not females. Again, not women. We don't know why that occurs, but we surmise it might be that in the areas where we're working, men are reluctant to go in for diagnosis and treatment. So they probably have more advanced TB when they go in. So they have higher bacterial counts, make it easier for the rats. Maybe, we're not sure of that. So this is some of our TB detection work. And always, we're trying to produce something of practical value, right? We're trying to make things better so the rats can work quicker or more accurately. And the rats are practical value. These are 2014 data from Tanzania. And our samples here are coming from about 20 clinics in Dar es Salaam, which is a big urban city, and in Morogoro. And the lower data path are detections by microscopy alone. The upper data path, microscopy plus pouch rats. And here, the overall increase in new case detections was 39%. So pretty close to what we found in other studies. The rats were well enough in Tanzania to be used elsewhere. And 3 years ago, we started a clinic in Maputo, Mozambique. And they're used in the same way for second line screening of sputum. These are data from Mozambique. And here we increase new case detections by 53%. So that's a sizable increase, right? So the rats are of practical value. Now, we've also looked at other applications. What else can the rats do? And we've shown that they can detect salmonella. Of course, salmonella is a major cause of foodborne illnesses in humans, but it's also a big problem in veterinary medicine. And you can detect it easily enough with extant techniques, but they're slow and fairly costly. So we thought maybe the rats could smell manure and determine whether or not salmonella are present. And we have proof of principle that they can do so. Now, it's a long way from proof of principle to some operational disease detection system, right? Now, you have to sort out all the details, but at least they can detect salmonella. They can detect cigarettes and other tobacco products. Well, how is that humanitarian? Well, trade in illicit cigarettes deprives developing countries of a lot of tax revenue. Moreover, funds derived in this way fund a lot of illicit enterprises, organized crime, even terrorism. Also, illicit cigarette distribution seems to increase underage smoking in a bunch of different countries, so it's a good bit of business, and our rats can detect cigarettes. Now, it's interesting that they do this in a remote scent tracing application. What we do is we put filters in containers in which there are cigarettes, and then the rats sniff those filters, and they can discriminate filters that have been placed in proximity of cigarettes from filters that have been placed in other circumstances. So that's the first step, right, in devising an operational system. What we're hoping to do eventually is to have an arrangement where we suck air out of, say, shipping containers through filters, and then we take those filters to our rats in a lab setting, and they sniff them and indicate whether or not tobacco was present. But again, it's a long way, right, from proof of principle to having some rat system that you can sell to people, right? I mean, you have to sell this to port authorities, to custom agents, you know, whomever. And a lot of people look askance at these rats. They say, well, that's so low tech. And you know, to that, I'm inclined to say, bullshit. There's nothing more high tech than a living creature, right? You know, I mean, they've got millions of years of evolution developing scent detection in these rats, right? Their lives depend on it. You know, we often joke we should put them in stainless steel containers with a lot of bells and whistles and a touchpad, then people might like them better. Especially with disease detection. You know, people just think it's medieval, but you know, it's not. The last application, again, we had proof of principle. This was really fun stuff. You know that sometimes people are trapped under debris, under fallen buildings, for instance, through accidents or acts of war or terrorism. And if you find living people quickly, they have a good chance of survival. But every hour that passes, their likelihood of survival declines precipitously. And dogs are really useful for finding people. But dogs can't penetrate the rubble. They're too big, right? And also, they don't like to go under stuff. So they typically walk over the rubble, and they make indicator responses when they smell a person. But our thought was, since these rats are nocturnal burrowing creatures, we might be able to teach them to go through and under debris, and then make indicator responses if they encounter people. And first we just went for people, but later we intended to go for living people. And we've published a couple studies showing that we could train rats to look for people. We simulated building collapses, and our rats would go out and find people. And they would also return when they heard a signal. And our notion was, if we ever have an operational system, the rats will be fitted with backpacks, and there'll be little cameras, right? And so we can see what the rats are seeing, and they'll have some way of making an indicator response. Maybe they'll bite a ball, and that will then activate the camera. And we can see, well, okay, here's a person, but is she or he alive? And we'll probably build in some way for the rats to communicate. But then we want the rats to return to their point of release, and we have proof of principle they can do that. Whether we'll ever get anything more than that, we don't know. But you know, these are the kinds of things we're looking at, right? What else can the rats do if via their scent detection abilities that might benefit people. Some other things, maybe they can detect cancer. A lot of interest in dog detection of cancer these days. We just finished a review of this literature, this 50-page article. You know, there's quite a few studies. Some of them are wanting methodologically, but others, you know, they're pretty good as best we can tell. So it looks like there may be some volatiles associated uniquely with cancer. And if dogs can detect them, so could rats. The second application, detecting Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's, I wouldn't have thought that possible, but some researchers who know this area suggest there may be biochemical scent markers of Alzheimer's disease that are present before there are any clinical signs. And if we can detect people who are going to develop Alzheimer's, then that makes the earliest possible intervention available, right? Now, right now, unfortunately, we don't have any good early interventions or later interventions for treating Alzheimer's disease, but people are working in that area. So there might really be something here. On the other hand, there might not, you know? The low-hanging fruit's not sweet. If you're trying to do good research, it's probably not going to be easy, is it? Especially if you're working in areas that are unfamiliar to you. You know, I don't know much of anything about Alzheimer's disease. I'm not well trained in biochemistry. So I have to depend on people who know those areas to tell me, well, you know, there's likely to be a biomarker here. And this is what it is, right? These are the chemicals. Well, when you do scent detection, there's a huge problem. As a human, I can't detect the actual stimuli that I want my animals to detect, right? You know, so I know that this sputum sample is TB positive by microscopy, right? But the rat's not reacting to what a microscopist said about the sample, right? The rat's reacting to how it smells. Well, to me, it doesn't smell like anything. It smells just the same as a clinic negative sample. And that poses a real challenge because scent detection research is easy to screw up. You can introduce extraneous variables without even knowing they exist. If you handle one kind of sample twice and the other kind of sample once, so your S pluses are handled twice, your S minuses once, the rats can detect that difference in handling. There's more human sample on the ones that were handled twice. So they detect whatever's easiest to detect, right? They don't give a shit about what you care about, right? You know, they're not detecting TB. They're doing what produces banana, right? And if detecting the smell of your hands produces banana more easily than detecting the smell of a microbe, well, they detect the smell of your hand. So I think this work is especially challenging. But it's been fun. It's been great stuff. I've gotten to work in a wonderful place with wonderful people. Research is always hard. Working in the developing world is sometimes especially challenging. If something breaks, it's hard to get it fixed. It's hard to get qualified scientists to go and stay for long periods. But that notwithstanding, this has been, for me, an excellent opportunity. I think the same is true of my graduate students, and certainly I know it's true of my family. It's been a wondrous opportunity, although it's caused us to expand our boundaries and to do things that we didn't do very well. And I'll close with this message. We can all do more than we imagine ourselves doing. But when we try to do that, we'll fail. And we'll fail repeatedly. The secret of success in behavior analysis, and I think in life, is to be resistant to punishment. You know? I mean, if you write a grant, you submit it, and you think it's the best thing since canned beer, and the reviewers hate it, curse them. Right? Curse them. Go out with your friends and, you know, commiserate. You know? Wake up the next morning with a hangover and go back to work. Right? Go back to work. learn from it. And eventually, it starts paying off. Or you learn it's never going to pay off, right? Sometimes you have to abort. You have to say, well, I think this is worthwhile, but nobody else on God's earth does. So unless I can fund it, I can't do it. And by I have, 37 euros, but I can't fund much research. So I've learned that I have to do work that other people care about, even though it may not be exactly what I want to do. And if you're going to be successful, you'll learn that too. I see some of my senior colleagues here, and they've all learned that. And you can embed often within work that you don't love, work that you do love. And that makes it worthwhile. Sad to say, at least in the United States, some people view applied behavior analysis as being a synonym of autism treatment. But it isn't. The work that we do to help people with autism and other developmental disabilities is wondrous work. I never argue we should do less of it. We should do more of it, right? We should extend our work in that area. But we should never lose track of the fact that we behavior analysts have tools that let us build a lot of things that are worthwhile. Now, to do that, we may have to extend ourselves. Maybe even to the point where we feel that we're, quote, selling out. But if you're doing good work, you're never selling out. It doesn't matter what words you use to describe that work, right? What matters is the outcome. What's the end result? Call it what you will, right? That's not what matters. What matters is changing the world in desirable ways. And all of us have skills that enable us to do that, beyond perhaps what we're doing now. But if you're doing something you love now, keep doing it. That's worthwhile. But I found over a long career that changing gears is invigorating. If you don't learn new things, you don't do much, right? You might be a one-trick pony. You're really good at that trick, and if it's a great trick, fine. But I think too many of us learn one song, and throughout our career, we just move the cape up. And you might be a one-hit wonder, but you may not have a hit at all. So look around, Check for possibilities. You don't have to be a leader with this APOPO work. God knows I haven't been a leader. I don't pilot the boat. I row the boat, right? I use what I can do to help other people who could do other, sometimes better things. And that for me is enough. Well, thanks a lot.